Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you, and it's good to have you back. It's so great to be able to worship and to praise our God. And before we do a couple of songs, before we bring our praises to God, I want to read from Psalm 145. I will read a couple of verses. And this psalm says like this: I will exalt you, my God and King, and praise your name forever and ever. I will praise you every day. Yes, I will praise you forever. Great is the Lord. He is most worthy of praise. No one can measure his greatness. I love these words. Great is the Lord. He is most worthy of praise. Let's praise him this morning. Let's praise him this morning. This is our response to who God is and to what God does to us. So let's sing this morning these words. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. I want to encourage you this morning to pour out your praise to God, and let's praise him with all our hearts and with all our souls. Let's sing these words. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you give life. You are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you give life. You are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out the praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out the praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out the praise to you only. Earth and all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out the praise to you only.
I fix my eyes upon the cross. I'm reaching out with all I've got. I'm letting go to start again. I need your love, that's why I'm here. Waiting outside my life it calls. But while I'm here I'll give my all. You are my peace within the storm. Here at the cross I find my home. You are greater, Jesus, you are greater than it all. You are greater, Jesus, you are greater than it all, than it all. Grace and mercy found me. Oh, the blood of Jesus is greater. Grace and mercy found me. Oh, the blood of Jesus is greater. Lord, I believe you rose again. I don't believe this is the end. You never fail, you have a plan. My life you hold within your hands. I walk by faith and not by sight. You are my source, you are my light. Wings, now I can fly. You are greater, you are greater, Jesus, you are greater than it all. You are greater, Jesus, you are greater than it all, than it all. Grace and mercy found me. Oh, the blood of Jesus is greater. Grace and mercy found me. Oh, the blood of Jesus is greater. Let's sing these words again. You are greater, Jesus. You are greater, Jesus, you are greater than it all. You are greater, Jesus, you are greater than it all, than it all. Grace and mercy found me. Oh, the blood of Jesus is greater. Grace and mercy found me. Oh, the blood of Jesus is greater. So unchanging, faithless one, you're my rock of peace, Lord of all, I depend on you, I call out to you again and again, I call out to you again and again.
Let's sing one more time. Faithful one,
faithful one, so unchanging, one, you're my rock of peace, Lord of all, I depend on you, I call out to you again and again, call out to you again and again. You are my rock in times of trouble. You lift me up when I fall down. Storms, your love is the anchor, my hope is in you alone.
Faithful one,
ageless one, you're my rock of peace, Lord of all, I depend on you, I call out to you again and again, I call out to you again and again. You are my rock in times of trouble. You lift me up when I fall down, all through the storms, your love is the anchor, my hope is in you. My rock in times of trouble, you lift me up when I fall down, all through the storm, your love. My heart is in you alone.
Yes, Lord, this is what we want to pray this morning. Our hope is in you alone. You are the source of our hope. You are our anchor. You are our shelter. You are our refuge. So we want to trust you. We want to put our hope in you. So we bless you this morning. And we thank you, Lord, that we can do so. We can do that. We can put our hope in you. And we can trust you. We thank you for that. Amen. Amen. And this is another great moment to praise our Lord with children. Right, boys and girls? I hope you are ready. We have the song from last week, I Won't Worry. So let's sing this song and let's believe what we sing. And let's say to our God that, yes, we don't worry, but we trust in you and we put our hope in you. I can imagine during this song how Aaron will dance, because we were talking about last week of actions or dancing, and I'm sure you saw how Nick danced with Nathaniel. So I would love to see Aaron dancing. So, but who knows? Hopefully Aaron will put on Facebook his dance. But let's sing together and let's don't worry, but put our hope and trust in Jesus. God bless you all.
Sky, not a cloud or a care for a million miles. I won't worry about a thing. God loves me and he loved me first. He rescued me when I was in a lurch, and I won't worry about a thing. And to the left I'll
everyone. I really hope that Nathan's dancing didn't put you off there. But it's true. We do not want to worry. We want to trust in God. He is faithful in all things, and He continues to be faithful in all circumstances. And one thing we don't want to worry is about the passing of time. Yesterday, a mighty man of God, a good friend, and a man that I respect very much, turned 25. Now, I'm talking about Victor Irwin. Just replace 2 to 7, and you get the right age. But we want to sing happy birthday to Victor. It's been such a blessing to have known you. It's been such a blessing to have Victor among us. So we're going to sing happy birthday. You know how to play it.
I'll try my best.
Okay, here we go. Victor, I hope and pray that you have had a beautiful birthday. Now, in terms of what's going to happen this week, just a matter of announcements. Let's start with tonight. Tonight, God willing, we're going to continue our lockdown conversations. And Michelle and I will be sitting down, and hopefully we'll be able to answer a question that Maya asked last week. Why doesn't God stop the coronavirus? So that's the conversation we're going to be having tonight. Then on Tuesday at 7:30, we're going to continue our Back to Basics series, our Back to Basics course. And at 7:30, we're going to be talking about the death of Jesus. So we've been talking about from the Bible, from Genesis to, we're going to go to new creation, and we are coming close to an end. We're going to talk about the death of Jesus. Then on Wednesday, 7:30, we're going to continue our Bible study in 1 Peter, and we're going to talk about the principle of submission within marriage and within church. We're going to talk about husbands and wives, and then we're going to talk about the relationship that we should have with each other in a church context. So that's the plan, and we hope and pray that God is going to bless us. This morning, we are back in the book of Hebrews, and we are going to talk about chapter 3, Hebrews chapter 3. So if you have your Bibles with you there, open with me to Hebrews chapter 3. We are going to talk about one of the second warning that the author of Hebrews gives us in terms of our relationship with God and our relationship to each other. And I suppose before we get reading, let's just bow our heads, and we're going to pray. And I want you to join me where you are at home. Let's just come before God and ask God to give us the wisdom through His Holy Spirit to help us understand what we are about to read. Sometimes when we read the Bible, we may find things a little bit more difficult. However, when the Holy Spirit comes to our aid and suddenly He opens our minds and He gives us the wisdom that we need to understand, everything comes alive in a very special way. So let's just pray, and we are going to read. Hebrews chapter 3. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for your goodness and mercy. I thank you for this beautiful day, and I thank you for the fact that you love us. Lord, it is a fact, and we rejoice in that knowledge of your complete love. Father, I thank you for Jesus, and I thank you for His life. I thank you for His death. I thank you for His resurrection and everything that they accomplished for us. I thank you that by faith we have eternal life. I thank you that you left the Holy Spirit to help us, to be our advocate, to be our helper. And today, O Lord, we are not standing before you in our own strength or righteousness, but we stand in the righteousness of Jesus Christ through the power of your Holy Spirit. And we rejoice in the relationship that we have with you, O God. Oh, Father, we thank you so much. We thank you for your word that we are about to read. We thank you that in your word we find comfort, strength, and blessing. I ask, O Lord, that you would be our portion this morning. I pray that you will be very close to us, that you will make these words come alive for us in a very special way. And as we read them, you would sanctify us through your Holy Spirit, and these words will become our strength. Oh God, I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Just before I start reading, let me just extend our sympathies to Elizabeth and Jonathan Coulter. Elizabeth lost her mother this week, and also we want to extend our sympathy to Nicola Parker and Scott Parker. Nicola lost her granddad this week. We love you, and we pray that God will continue to comfort you and strengthen you at this difficult time. This is not an easy time to have a funeral. We acknowledge that, and we want to stand with you in your grief, and we want to pray that God will be your strength. May God bless you and give you his peace. Let's read together Hebrews chapter 3. Jesus is greater than Moses. And so, dear brothers and sisters who belong to God and are partners with those called to heaven, think carefully about this Jesus whom we declare to be God's messenger and high priest. In other translation, we read those that, first of all, brothers and sisters who belong to God and are partakers in the heavenly calling. And then he refers to Jesus as our apostle. We're going to go back and explain those terms later on. Verse 2. For he was faithful to God who appointed him, just as Moses served faithfully when he was entrusted with God's entire house. But Jesus deserves far more glory than Moses, just as a person who builds a house deserves more praise than the house itself. For every house has a builder, but the one who built everything is God. Moses was certainly faithful in God's house as a servant. His work was an illustration of the truth God would reveal later. But Christ as the Son is in charge of God's entire house, and we are God's house if we keep our courage and remain confident in our hope in Christ. That is why the Holy Spirit says, today when you hear his voice, don't harden your hearts as Israel did when they rebelled, when they tested me in the wilderness. There your ancestors tested and tried my patience, even though they saw my miracles for 40 years. So I was angry with them, and I said, their hearts always turn away from me. They refuse to do what I tell them. So in my anger, I took an oath. They will never enter my place of rest. Be careful then, dear brothers and sisters. Make sure that your own hearts are not evil and unbelieving, turning you away from the living God. You must warn each other every day while it is still today, so that none of you will be deceived by sin and hardened against God. For if we are faithful to the end, trusting God just as firmly as when we first believe, we will share in all that belongs to Christ. Remember what it says. Today, when you hear his voice, don't harden your hearts as Israel did when they rebelled. And who was it who rebelled against God, even though they heard his voice? Wasn't it the people Moses led out of Egypt? And who made God angry for 40 years? Wasn't it the people who sinned, whose corpses lay in the wilderness? And to whom was God speaking when he took an oath that they would never enter his rest? Wasn't it the people who disobeyed him? So we see that because of their unbelief, they were not able to enter his rest. Amen. I pray that these words that we've just read will become a blessing to us. Now, let's just remember what we've been talking about so far. I think it's very important and very good to put the words that we've just read into context, because out of context, we might just get the wrong conclusion. You see, the book of Hebrews was initially written with a purpose in mind. Whoever wrote the book of Hebrews, we don't know who that was. Some people say Paul, some people say Barnabas, some people say Priscilla, and so on. We don't know exactly who, but whoever wrote it with one purpose in mind, to encourage people, the people of God, his church, to run the race of this Christian life with confidence in who Jesus is. The purpose is, in a sense, summed up in this verse in Hebrews chapter 12. Let's say it together. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. In a sense, this is the purpose of the whole book of Hebrews. And the reason for that encouragement is that a lot of people in times of difficulty were finding Christian life too much. And so they were either thinking about giving up and returning to the Jewish rituals and religion. Others may have just given up. Or others were entertaining the thought of maybe believing in Jesus, but they weren't sure if that's the right thing to do. To those that are about to give up, the writer of Hebrews says, I want you to see how much you have in Jesus. To those that have given up to have faith in Jesus, the writer of Hebrews says, I want you to come back, because in Jesus you have so much more. He's greater than the angels. He's greater than Moses. His covenant is greater. There is eternal life in him, and so on. And those that are maybe thinking about putting their faith in Jesus, the author of Hebrews is simply presenting them with enough knowledge about Jesus to help them understand that choosing Jesus is so much better than anything else in this life. I guess with everybody, there is a great temptation to slip back into a religion of works. What I mean by that is, you see, my relationship with Jesus is based on faith. However, it is a relationship. And let me tell you something, relationships are not easy. And it's probably within our instinct to find it easier to slip into this religious mode where I am in control of how I feel, I'm in control of who I worship, what I do when I worship. That control seems to make me feel good. Therefore, I seem to find easier to be religious rather than be in a relationship with the living God. You see, the relationship not only that takes a little bit of effort, but takes great honesty. You see, in a religious aspect, in a religious ritual, you can put up an appearance, and you may seem to be absolutely perfect, but that just may be the outward appearance. Inside, you could be just as far away from God as possible. And so the question is, why is religion so appealing? Because you see, it focuses more on the forms, on the appearance of piety, on good deeds, rather than developing this close, intimate relationship with Jesus that is based on honesty and reality. Religion gives man control, generates a feeling of well-being in spite of the reality of sin. We seem to control what we worship. We create our gods according to our likening. We revere personalities. We're going to talk about Moses in a minute, rather than God himself. And so when the writer of Hebrews gets to this point, he is warning people against going back to a religious system that may appear to be the right thing, but is void of any reality and substance. And he's trying to stir us back into this vibrant and exciting relationship with the living God. And one thing that I believe becomes the focus here in chapter 3 is this amazing personality of Moses. Moses seems to be the central figure of the Jewish religion. If you look into the Old Testament, you find that everything that is about the Old Covenant is to do with Moses. We have the Law of Moses. We have the Mosaic Covenant or the Covenant of Moses. We have the Pentateuch. The first five books of the Bible are written by Moses. So whenever these Jewish believers were finding difficult to live in this relationship with Jesus, then they seemed to find it easier to go back to keep some rules from the Mosaic Law and be faithful to Moses rather than to Jesus. So the writer of Hebrews wants us to understand that there's no point to worship Moses because Jesus is so much better. There is a clear danger for us today. We may say, hold on a second, I'm not in danger of going after Moses instead of following Jesus. I'm not in danger of going to be circumcised instead of living by faith in the new covenant of Jesus. But what we are in danger of is to become lethargic, to become cold, to become religious rather than be involved in a relationship with Jesus. We can so easily drift towards an outward appearance of piety and religious manifestation rather than go back to this simple, honest relationship with Jesus. We drift back by ignoring the truth. And we talked about that last week. That's why the first warning that the author of Hebrews, there are five warnings in this book. The first one we talked about last week, and the first one was, I be careful not to drift away from the truth that you heard. You do that by ignoring it. So whenever you ignore the truth, you start drifting away. So the warning last week was, do not drift away. The second warning comes in chapter 3 and beginning of chapter 4, and it's against doubt. Do not doubt. Do not doubt by allowing your heart to become hardened. In this second warning, the second warning comes with a statement about who we are. Then comes the warning, do not doubt, and the warning is supported by arguments about why Jesus is so much greater than Moses. Now, I want you to follow the logic of the writer. I love the simplicity of the structure of this book, and as you read, you can see it very well laid down before your eyes. Remember the first warning that we talked about last week, do not drift. So the first warning is do not drift from the word of God by ignoring the truth you heard. And then the arguments supporting that warning come in relation to the humanity of Jesus. Do not drift away from this truth. Because Jesus came in flesh, he understands what you're going through. He understands your trials. He understands your temptation. He understands your weaknesses. So don't drift away. Then the second warning comes, do not doubt the word of God by allowing your heart to become hard. And the argument supporting that are coming in the fact that the author wants us to understand Jesus is so much greater than Moses. So don't doubt the word of God in regards to Jesus. Why don't drift? Why don't doubt? It's simply because God wants us to run this race with confidence. Confidence in who Jesus is. Confidence in who we are as followers of Jesus Christ. Now, when the warning comes, and I want to say this before we get into the actual text, when the warning comes and says, do not doubt, the author is not saying doubts will not come, because they do come. Doubts come all the time. You're sitting down, and I don't know about you, but I certainly experience this. I sit down and my mind starts to wander, and suddenly I begin to ask myself, what if I'm wrong about everything? So it's not as if the author is saying you will never have a doubt, and if you doubt, you're in trouble. What the author does is giving us the warning against doubt, because if you allow this doubt to bear fruit in your mind, the immediate result is a hard heart. So what we do with the doubt is crucial in this Christian life. The best thing that you can do with doubt is to take that doubt and make it your best friend. In other words, when doubt comes to my mind, what I do, instead of allowing it to cause hardness to the heart and start to be deceived within my heart, I go back to the Word of God and say, oh, I wonder what God says about this. Well, we're going to talk about suffering later on. Why doesn't God stop coronavirus? And I'm sure a lot of you have gone through situations and circumstances where you ask yourself or started to doubt, what is God all about? What is God really doing here? And instead of allowing that doubt to make your harden your heart against God, the best thing to do is to take that doubt and check it with the Word of God. And as I submit my doubts to God, and as He confirms to me His truth, my faith grows because of that doubt. Rather than going hard against God, I get to be softer and softer because I brought that doubt to God. So what should we do? Let's start with, first of all, what we are told here in the first few verses. In chapter 3, before the author gives us the warning, he's creating this introduction. He's creating this picture of who we are. And I want you to notice, who is this warning addressing? So, dear brothers and sisters who belong to God. So, from the beginning, we understand that this warning is addressed not to the unbelieving people that are in the world, but to the church of Jesus Christ, to the brothers and sisters. This warning is addressed to those that not only are brothers and sisters in Christ and they belong to God, but are partakers of everything that is in heaven. As some translation put it, partakers of the heavenly calling. We are partners with those that are called in heaven. We are bigger than what we see. The church of Jesus Christ is much larger than what we see with our physical eyes. And then it tells us here, it calls us. You see, the only way we can fight against doubt is to do two things. Hopefully you will be able to see this on the screen. The author of Hebrews calls us to this amazing truth. Think carefully. Think carefully. We are invited to this thinking process. We are invited to think clearly. Look at this. So, dear brothers and sisters who belong to God and are partners with those called to heaven, think carefully about this Jesus whom we declare to be God's apostle or messenger, the sent one. The word apostle simply means to be sent, the sent one. Apostle and high priest. So first, the author of Hebrews says this. if you want to deal with doubt when it comes, because it will come, what you need to do is to think clearly. Think about who you are in Jesus Christ. You belong to God, and you are partaker of this heavenly calling. You are partnered with the whole crowd of witnesses. We're going to be talking about that in Hebrews 12. You are part of this amazing crowd of believers. God has blessed you not only with the position in Christ, a blessed position in Christ, but also he has surrounded you with a crowd of people that are there to support you. So think about who you are and think carefully about who Jesus is. He is not only a messenger of the good news, but he's a high priest. And we talked about in the previous chapter, a high priest that understands all your weaknesses. And yet he was without sin, therefore he can provide a sacrifice. The audience, brothers and sisters who belong to God, partners or partakers with those called to be in heaven. I need you to understand who you are in Jesus Christ. And when doubt comes, think carefully about who you are. Think carefully about how Jesus made you into his partner, into his brother or sister. Think about his death. Think about him, the apostle of good news, the high priest of our souls. And one thing that we can conclude as we think carefully about this is that he was faithful in all things. Then the author of Hebrews goes on to compare Jesus to Moses. And to the author, we clearly find that although Moses was faithful in his work in the house, Jesus is the builder of the house. Because through him, God made everything. So it's wonderful to respect somebody that is faithful working in the house, but the one that actually built the house has much greater honor. If Moses was a servant in God's house, Jesus is the son in God's house. Although we respect the one that is faithful as a servant in the house of God, there is much greater honor and much greater worship to the son in God's house. So what do we do when doubt comes? What can we do in order to submit this doubt and compare it with the truth? And instead of allowing that doubt to make our heart hard or to harden our hearts against God, what can we do? Think carefully. We've got this invitation to reason and logical thinking. Who am I? Who is Jesus to me? What is it that I know about Jesus that makes him greater than the most revered person in the history? Well, I know who I am. I am a child of God. How did I become a child of God? Well, Jesus died for me, and God has given me the grace to believe that by his death, he paid the penalty of my sin. And when I put my trust in him, when I put my faith into him, his substitute, his death became the payment for my sin. And because he died, now I have eternal life.
And so then I repent of my sin and I follow Jesus. That's how I become a child of God. And when I become a child of God, I am brother with Jesus. I am a sister of Jesus. We are in a crowd surrounded by brothers and sisters. This is who I am. Think carefully about who he is. Well, who is Jesus? He's our apostle. He is our messenger. What did he bring? When God sent him down, what did he come? What did he come with? He came with the good news. What's that? The kingdom of God is here. Believe and you will have eternal life. That's the good news. That's the good news. Not only that he brought the good news, but he became the good news. He became the good news when he was able to identify with all our weaknesses. He became the good news when he laid down his life for me. And so when doubt comes, I want to go and think carefully about who I am, who Jesus is, and then my doubt is submitted to God and my faith increases instead of allowing my heart to become hard. Then the author of Hebrews calls us to not just think carefully, but to behave carefully. Look at verse 12. Be careful then. That in a sense involves a behavior, an action. So if the first advice is, I want you to think carefully, the second one is more to do with action. I want you to be careful then, dear brothers and sisters. Make sure that your own hearts are not evil and unbelieving, turning you away from the living God. You must warn each other every day while it is still today, so that none of you will be deceived by sin and hardened against God. For if we are faithful to the end, trusting God just as firmly as when we first believed, we will share in all that belongs to Christ. Remember what it says. I love this invitation to careful action. What am I supposed to do when doubt comes? Well, I need to think carefully. And we've covered that. Who am I in Jesus Christ? Who is Jesus? And we meditate on that. And we allow that to sink deep within us when doubt comes. Jesus and the knowledge, the rationale behind who I am and who he is can help my faith. But also I'm called to action, to be careful. And that comes with a careful, first of all, self-examination. What sort of behavior do I need to employ when doubt comes? Well, it says here, be careful then, dear brothers and sisters. Make sure that your own hearts are not evil and unbelieving, turning you away from the living God. When was the last time you had a frank conversation with your heart? You may say, Nick, that's just a bit. Listen, read the Psalms of David. And you'll find in the Psalms that David has lengthy conversations with himself. He talks about, oh my soul, why are you cast down? Why are you low? Here's what you need to do, my soul. I want you to praise the Lord. Does that make sense? It's good sometimes to have a conversation with yourself and say, Nick, how is the condition of your heart? What's the action that the author here is encouraging us to take? Well, behave carefully. What's that? What does that involve? Well, it begins with careful self-examination. Where is my heart today? But it doesn't let me just sink within myself, because that can be dangerous. You can be so hard on yourself that you forget who you are. You forget who Jesus is, and you think that it's all about beating yourself up. No. Listen. What else we need to do is to encourage each other. Careful encouragement of each other. You must warn each other every day while it is today, so that none of you will be deceived by sin and hardened against God. When doubt comes, it has the potential to make your heart hard against God. How can we overcome that? First, think carefully. Think careful about who you are. Think careful about who Jesus is. Now, take some action. Behave carefully about your soul. Do your self-examination and encourage others. Warn each other. May allow this exchange of encouragement to take place in the Church of Jesus Christ. When you see somebody drifting away, you go and say, "My brother, what's happening? I want to help you. This is not a good direction." Then the author closes with this lesson from history. And he says, I want you to look at what Israel did in the wilderness. How first they started with excitement, then things got very difficult. Then they started to doubt God. Then they rebelled against Moses and they doubted Moses' calling. Even his sister and his brother went and said, "Who is this Moses? Can God only speak through him?" And so this people of God that God had chosen and allowed them to see mighty miracles, even they got their hearts hardened before him. When doubt came, instead of presenting their doubt to God and going through that self-examination, encouraging one another, spurring each other on, remembering who they are, remembering who God is, remembering all his miracles. Instead of doing that, they focus so much on themselves. Their heart got so hard against him, and many of them perish in the wilderness, never entering Canaan. Listen, there is a place that God desires you to be. That is a place of rest with him, where you rest assured in your own salvation, rest assured in your relationship with Jesus, filled with the joy of your salvation, filled with the joy of knowing that you have a right standing with God, not because of your own goodness, but because of the righteousness of Jesus Christ. So when doubt comes, and let's be honest with each other. Oh, doubt will come. And it is at moments like these, whenever we see society collapsing and we see so many negative things happening, we suddenly find ourselves thinking, where is God in all this? It's easy to allow doubt to take over your heart, and before you know it, your heart is so hard before God that you feel away from him. Or at least you feel that God has abandoned you somehow, and yet it is just a matter of the heart. Dear friend, dear brother and sister, when doubt comes, I want you to think carefully. Think carefully about who you are. Think carefully about who Jesus is. And then do something about it. Have a good look at your heart. Go through that self-examination and ask yourself, heart, how is it? I was having a conversation with Michelle this morning and I said to her, honey, I just feel my heart growing a bit cold. I need to do something about that. It's always good to have a good look at your heart, but it's also good to have the encouragement of others or be an encouragement to others. And as I speak to you, is anything that the Lord is saying to you about your own heart, or is anything the Lord is saying to you about somebody else that needs your encouragement, that needs your blessing? Maybe you need to pick up the phone and text somebody that needs an encouragement right now. Learn from history. Learn to rest in Jesus Christ. So, let me just finish. I know the doubt will come. What do you do when doubt comes? Think carefully. Think about who you are. Think about who Jesus is. And then behave carefully. Do something about it. Maybe you need to examine your heart. Maybe you need to go through that self-examination. And don't allow your heart to get hard. If you already sense that your heart is growing cold, do something about it. Tell something about it. Tell someone about it. And maybe that person could sit with you or kneel with you and pray together that your heart may become soft again and filled with joy. Let's warn each other. Let's keep each other close to Jesus. This is the best thing that we can do when doubt comes. Brother, I'm not really sure how I feel. Can you pray with me? Sister, I'm feeling called towards Jesus. Can you pray with me? Be honest. Don't let your heart get hard. When doubt comes, you can either take it to the Lord, and then your faith grows, or you allow your doubt to harden your heart. And before you know, you start drifting away. Let's encourage each other to the first response. Doubt, you hear, that's fine. I'm going to take you to the truth. And I'm going to think carefully about who I am. I'm going to think carefful about who Jesus is. I'm going to examine my heart. I'm going to allow others to encourage me. I'm going to learn from the history of God's word. And I'm going to grow in my faith because this is who I am in Jesus Christ. You see? Maybe you are in that place. Your heart is hard and you think that it's impossible to come back. It's never impossible to come back. Will you come back? Will you be honest about it? And say, Lord, my heart is hard. I've allowed doubt to take away my joy, to take away my peace, to take away the vitality of my relationship with Jesus. I need to do something about it. I want to remind you that you can go to God anytime, but if you want our encouragement, if you want our prayers, we'll love to help you do that because God's purpose for you is to be in a vibrant relationship with Jesus. God doesn't want you to slip into this religious form of doing the right things for feeling better, denying God's power, denying God's conviction, denying the reality of sin in your life. Don't become religious. Let God deal with us today. Let's pray together. Then we're going to say goodbye. There will be some music at the end. And just allowing you to meditate on what you heard this morning. And if there is anything that you want to say, please comment on the video. We'll be here to help you through this journey. If you want to text me or message me on Facebook or phone me or email me, do whatever you need to do. But don't let your heart get hard towards God. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for your amazing grace. And I thank you that you are gracious enough to remind us of who we are in Jesus Christ. You are gracious enough to remind us of who Jesus is. He is greater than Moses. He is greater than the angels. And he is here to bless us. He is here to encourage us. He is the builder of the house. He is the son in the house. And he is my brother. My Savior and my Lord. What a joy to know you, Jesus. Lord, I bring my heart before you, and I pray that you will give me the joy of salvation. I pray that you will fill it with the Holy Spirit, and I will again experience your closeness and the joy and the love that only you, Holy Spirit, can bring to me. Oh God, set me aflame again. Set me ablaze. Let me burn for you with holy fire. In spite of this lockdown, in spite of the circumstances, allow me to experience the fullness of your Holy Spirit. I ask the same for the whole church, for those that are listening right now. Fill us with your Holy Spirit and make us aware of your presence. From now on, I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. May God bless you and give you his peace. We'd love to see you tonight. And as I always say, I cannot wait to see you here in the church in the flesh. We all miss you. We miss you so much. And we look forward to seeing you soon. God bless you.
To the Lamb, honor and glory, worthy is he who overcame, buried in shame, risen in power.